Right.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the June 4th Olathe Public Schools Board of Education meeting. We're so glad you're here. Would you do the roll call, Joy?
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Here.
McCune?
Here.
Mr. Parker?
Here.
Mr. Poland?
Here.
Mr. Shear?
Here.
Dr. Daniels?
Here.
Right. Would you stand with me for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So, first night in a long while, we haven't needed our umbrellas or raincoats, so it's good to have you here on a somewhat dry night. We're going to start out with Dr. Banikowski sharing with us the parent survey results for 2014-2015.
Good evening. It's great to have the opportunity to talk with you just a little bit about our parent survey results from this school year. As we talk about some of the results, I'm going to just highlight a few of those areas for you. First of all, we remember that our annual parent survey looks at several areas, five that I've listed up there, from our national questions to the district as a whole to individual schools. And I'll give you just a few highlights from that. First of all, in the area of the national questions that we ask, you can see there all of our scores are so high, all above 95%, which is unheard of, I think, of as we look at survey results. I think you also compare it to the national survey, which the Gallup poll also does with these same particular questions. You can see that for the wide-ranging audience that answers this nationally, 50% feel that their school should be rated an A or a B, ours, of course, at 98%. And another area that we look at is the school your oldest child attends. A high score was for the nationally, 67% would receive an A or a B. You can see for us, it's 97%. So again, very positive results from our parents who responded to the survey. The district as a whole, we have a variety of questions that we ask to get a gauge, if you will, of how the district is doing. And I highlighted just a few of them for you here. And the first one, the community gets excellent value for their taxes paid. And I gave you a glimmer of the last 3 years of the results there. You can see that was an increase to a 92%. The district demonstrates budget accountability and transparency, and that's been an area I know that Mr. Hutchison has looked at as well as others, and you can see the great increase that we have had in that area with an increase to 87% from last year at 70%. And the district has up-to-date technology, and of course, that has a lot to do with a lot of the initiatives that you have supported as a Board of Education, and that was, again, a very high increase and 96% for our respondents to the survey. Again, very positive results when we looked at the district as a whole. The next area is the Board of Education. You can also see that all those scores were above a 90%, and that's a very exciting and a challenging time when it's hard to communicate with so many people. But you can see the decisions by the Board of Education, the balance between students and staff and community, as well as providing appropriate resources, and so challenging in this budget climate that we're in right now. So again, those are very high percentages, and we should feel very good about those, especially when we look at what the results were in 2007-2008. Another area is we also look at all of our schools at the levels, elementary, middle, and high. And so you can kind of, and I just highlighted just a few of those. Students are able to get extra help when needed. And you know, that's such an important part and it's so challenging as class sizes have increased. But you can see 96% for high school, 93% for middle, and 94% for elementary. I kind of went back to where it's there. My students feel safe at school. And isn't that such an important hallmark in our day and age where sometimes safety is such an important factor for schools schools as well as other places in our community. And you can see those high percentages there. My gosh, 99%, I don't think you can hardly get any higher than that. And then our students has at least one adult that they can turn to if there's a problem. And that's so important as well. And that's a high area. Of course, we're looking at all the scores as well as the high scores, a few of the areas that might have dipped. And we're also looking at that with our principals as well in that particular area. Transportation, I thought I'd put this up here because not, of course, everybody who responded to the survey had students who were in our transportation or rode the school bus. But again, these were very, very high scores. And in many cases, as you can see, they're all in an increase, except for one, the bus driver treats patrons in a professional manner. But again, that was 91%, so it's virtually unchanged. And very positive results, and I think that's also says a lot about the bus company improving that, as well as the expectations that individuals in the school district have set forth for that bus company. Another area, of course, we're looking at are our comments, and we have looked at all those from a district perspective. We analyze those at our senior leadership team meeting, and we have looked at all those particular areas that you see on the board there on the screen. In addition, every principal has had the comments from their school, and they've analyzed those to see if there's areas that are really good that we want to make sure we keep going, but there might be areas of questions or concerns that they want to concentrate on for the coming school year. So again, all those areas were looked at. You know, I think this is probably, to me, one of the most important questions that we ask, and that is, how satisfied are you overall with the Olathe Public Schools? Last year, it was 94%, and you a little bit think about, oh my gosh, that's a very high score. How are we going to beat that score? But we could look at what we have this year, and it's 96% of our patrons feel that they are very satisfied with the Olathe Public Schools. So again, that's something that I think we can all be very proud of. And as we look at it, I always think that we need to have it so we give information to our public. Maggie Kolb has been working with me, as well as Erica Darrington at the Graphic Communications. And we will have a story on our website that highlights the parent survey and some of the results. And you can see that even though in these four particular areas that we picked, even though we are very high last year, you can see that all those areas have increased. Even though they might have increased from 96% to 98%, it's very positive. And again, we picked four areas that we thought that demonstrated some of the information that we received from our patrons. So that is kind of a highlight of the parent survey results from this school year, and I'd be glad to take any questions that you might have.
Thank you. Any questions, comments?
You probably covered the start of it. What was the percentage of parents that responded?
I knew you were going to ask that, and I should have memorized that off the top of my head, and I didn't. I don't remember that. It's a very good question, though. Okay. And I have that.
Okay.
I didn't bring that notebook down. I could send that to you. Okay.
The, you know, actually, my
there were 3,200.
I think it was in the report.
3,200 parents. I just
what percentage?
Curious what percentage that was.
Okay. And I can send that as well.
And go along with good results. I think just from KASB today, they said that Kansas ranked among top states in student achievement and efficient spending. So yeah. I think some of these results hope are reflected possibly in what's going on. I guess from these results, I guess I'd have to challenge the new board members. If it goes down, we'll have to know who to blame.
Such a challenge. I also think that as we look at the results, you know, sometimes I wish we had more responses to these results and to the survey, but I guarantee if there was a lot of dissatisfaction, we would have very high responses. So I think this says a lot about our school district and our patrons feeling good, our parents feeling good about the results. So thank you, Mr. Poland. That's good.
Dr. Benikowski, these are all great results, and it's wonderful to see the increase with this. There was one that was a little bit lower,
yes.
And that was the bullying in the high school level.
Yes, the high school level.
Have you had a chance to look into that, or what are we going to do to be able to at least look at that a little bit and see what might have I don't know what it was last year, but that's pretty glaring compared to the other elementary and middle
compared
school.
To the other levels, that was of concern to us, and I've talked and worked with Dr. Dugan on that. One of the areas that we the last 2 years, we've been able to add our Hispanic results. So we provide the survey in Spanish as well. And that did negatively impact that particular score. It was only above a 70% when we took those scores out. So we want to make sure that we're looking at that. It is to have some relationship to our Hispanic students. We're looking at the high school level. We've had a conversation with our high school principals. So we don't know if it's an anomaly. There weren't tons of comments in that particular area because we thought that would be adding to it. So we're just not sure in that particular area. But we are studying it. Okay. It's obviously of concern to us.
Is that something we can go back? I know we only do this annually, but again, because that score is a little bit low, and that's something that's really out
very
in the public quite a bit.
Prominent.
Is that something we can go back and relook at or retest somewhere down the road after we've made some either adjustments or some thoughts or ideas of what might be driving that?
We're going to talk some more even this next week with high school principals about this. You know, it's a one-year piece, and it could just be an anomaly. Right. We have some other measures to look at to compare it to. So if we track like our CTC data that would have our 10th and 12th graders, it hasn't shown up there. But then also this past year, we didn't do that survey. We're going to pick it back up. So we'll watch some measures on either side of it. It's a little odd, and it's lower than previous years. I mean, this hasn't been a trend in high school, even compared to the other areas. So some discussion, we'll look at some other measures to see what's going on and certainly watch it. And then probably do some surveying at the individual building levels to get a sense from staff and students. So we've got more work to do. It kind of surprised all of us.
Great.
So
great.
Real unexpected.
Thank you.
Dr. Banikowski, can you speak to, you had referenced there weren't a lot of comments, but when you do receive comments, can you share what that process is? What do we do with the comments?
Yes, the comments are really important to us, both the compliments and the concerns. We look at them from an individual basis in terms of staffing, general program information, budget information. So the different individuals in this room that are on senior leadership actually look at those areas. For example, John Hutchison has studied all the comments related to budget. He brings a document to the entire senior leadership group. It tells you exactly what the differentiation might have been on those comments. Maybe what it was, there a pattern to anything that we saw? Were they random comments? Both from the compliments and the concerns. So all that is extremely analyzed. We just actually finished that process at senior leadership. As well, then an individual school has that information as well. So Briarwood Elementary principal has that information for his or her school. In addition, the appraiser of that different level, for example, Dr. Dugan, has looked at all the middle school results to see if there's an area of concern, or maybe there's a lot of celebration, which we determine with a lot of it. So we look at the comments, because sometimes a comment may be random, but it's something that might lead us to something else that we want to look at a little further. Same with compliments. We had a lot of compliments about individual teachers, individual schools, and principals, which are great to see. It tells you a lot about that school and that people took the time to make a comment about that. So they're very analyzed.
Good. And we develop action plans,
yes,
on one that would, you know, dictate that would be necessary.
Yeah. And we tried to make sure that we aren't reacting to, okay, maybe there was two negative comments, but the results were very positive. So we tried to look and compare between the results and the comments.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Any other questions or thoughts? Thank you so much. That was an encouraging report. And Mike, thanks for bringing up the KASB. Good information today. They sent out Kansas Association for School Boards sent out a very encouraging email saying that the quote was that the data shows that no state has better results with fewer resources than Kansas. That's a big deal. It's no state in the United States. So that was good news. A rose among the thorns, I guess you could say, in this budget battle we're in. So let's move into the action consent agenda, items 5.01 through 5.15. Any discussion on any of that?
No, I move to approve the consent agenda items numbered 5.01 to 5.15 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Mr. Scheer, a second by Mr. McCune. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
All right, on to 6.01, under action bids, contracts, and agreements. KASB and National School Board Association fees. Any dialogue or questions about this?
Mary, would you mind just kind of sharing a little bit of some of the benefits that we get from KASB and why this is something important for us to look at?
Sure. One of the early benefits that they get and we use quite often is the legal assistance. Most school boards in Kansas have the board meetings on Monday nights. They even put somebody on call on Monday nights in their office so that if a board wants to call in during a meeting and ask a legal question, they can. That doesn't work as well for us on Thursday evenings, but we do utilize that service because their attorneys on staff deal with education law 100%. And so we can always get a good answer. And so even though we have Scott on staff, we quite often will call and ask about situations or interpretations, discipline situations, and so forth. So that's really important. Training is another big piece for us, not only the state convention, but all kinds of workshops. Scott will be going to an update this summer on school law. There's HR workshops that are given by the association, but a large number of training pieces that we can pick up. The next key thing for us, I think, really is the information that we get just instantaneously almost when the legislature's in session. I don't think you could drive home from Topeka before we would have something already from KESB, what's happened that afternoon or that morning, so it's very positive. And then Mark Tallman, as some of you have been participating with, he does the webinars almost every Friday during the session. Again, very beneficial to hear it from him and to get the handouts. We get a lot of publications that are available to us from KESB. And also now KESB is really the source for us for board docs. I think they have that responsibility now for the state of Kansas, so that's a great connection for us. So Kansas Association School Boards, we get a lot for our money, I think. The national level is similar. A lot of information that we get, and the biggest piece that I like there is the analysis that comes with it. Sometimes something's happening in Washington, D.C., and then we get that broken down for us in terms of what that might mean for school districts. In better times, we used to send more board members to the national conference, which is also always beneficial, I think. At the reception this afternoon, a number of the former board members talked about the days gone by when the whole board used to go for training, because it can be very positive that way. Again, publications are good. American School Board Journal is real positive. Sometimes they're a source of grants for us at the national level that we can receive. So again, a lot of information that we get. Very positive on both counts.
Great. The only other thing I wanted to add to that, because I agree with you 100%, all the information that we're able to receive, but being a part of KASB is us being able to represent ourselves with KASB from a state standpoint. Certainly. And being able to be on the board, being part of legislative committee and things such as that. Very important for us to be able to get out there and be a part of this because, you know, we are a very large school district and we want to be able to have some input into, you know, some of the different things that are happening in Topeka, and this is just another avenue for us to be able to participate with that.
Other comments?
Just as a decision-making process next year, is there a way of tabulating the cost avoidance, like, you know, legal counsel we get from them, number of hours, any way of tabulating that just to, you know, justify to the public this expense?
Sure. We could track some of that.
Okay. Thank you.
I'd entertain a motion.
I move to approve 2015-2016 KASB membership dues of $19,060, KASB legal assistance fund service fee of $1,650, and NSBA national connection fees of $8,620 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Ms. Martin, second by Mr. Shear. Roll call vote, please.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
All right, 6.02, textbooks, secondary mathematics. This is to approve at the purchase of textbooks. Any questions or comments? Motion?
I move to approve the purchase of textbooks, secondary mathematics from Pearson for $89,000 and from Cengage for $133,000 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Ms. Martin, second by Mr. McCune. Roll call vote.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
All right, 6.03, Curriculum and Textbooks, International Language, High School French. Part of the curriculum cycle. Any questions or dialogue? Okay, a motion?
I move to approve revised curriculum and the purchase of texts and instructional materials for high school international language French 4 and AP French 5 courses from Vista Higher Learning for $9,000 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Dr. Daniels, second by Mr. Parker. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
All right, 6.04, 2015 and 2016 transportation safety variance areas. Dr. Berry, would you be willing to define what this is?
State law says that we are to pick up students who are more, 2.5 miles or more from their homes. And so that's number one for transportation. We also have then the ability for some of our neighborhoods and students and families to pay to ride the bus. But then we also have some other situations that we claim are a little bit more difficult for that student, even if they wanted to walk. And so we create a variance that says we're able to provide that transportation option, even though it might be a mile or a mile and a half, something less than that. So each year we just establish these variances. They usually stay the same. Occasionally a new one will crop up in terms of if a new subdivision comes up. But it's purely so that we have these variances established as we go into registration for the new school year and parents can make that choice.
And it's mainly about safety, isn't it?
It is very much about safety.
Okay.
Yeah.
And in these variances, are these paid or unpaid routes? Or is
there
a variety?
They have the option. They don't live, aren't equipped with free busing, but we think the area might not be conducive to walking.
Right.
But so they have an option to send some buses in and they can pay for it.
Very good.
Motion?
I would move to approve the Olathe public transportation variance for the 2015-16 school year as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Mr. McCune, second by Ms. Martin. Roll call vote, please.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
All right, 6.05 network electronics bid. This is, do we need any discussion on this or have any questions?
What is this covering, Rita?
These are the switches that we'll use to connect the Apple TVs in the middle school classrooms. So part of those additional peripheral equipment that we talked about when we approved the iPads for the middle school.
And again, just so you know, the Apple TV in a classroom means that the teacher with an iPad can place what's on their iPad up on the screen or from any of the students and their iPads can be shared that way. So it's really makes for good learning that way.
So the funding source is bond 2013.
Right. Yep.
Questions?
I'd move to award the bid to Sirius Computer Solutions for $173,520 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Mr. Poland, second by Ms. Martin. Roll call vote, please.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
All right, we have 6.06 trade bids for Olathe West High School. Do we want to have Greg come up and share a little about the bullet points, or do we have?
Be fine.
Okay. Sorry to put you on the spot, Greg.
I can just give you a brief overview of these and then answer any questions you might have. This is sort of the ninth bid package, the ninth group of work packages we've put together. There were two bid alternates associated with these. Once again, it's this bid alternate 13, which is the support building. The last time we had talked about, you know, we had some change orders we were writing for part of that building. We had some bids we accepted that night for part of it, and then we had some estimates for the future. These are those future bids. For some of the small pieces that go along with 13. Bid alternates 27A and 27B. The first floor of the building is designed to have a limestone veneer on it. These are man-made products that are options to that limestone.
It was really more of a pricing exercise. You know, there was some indication from salespeople who sell man-made products that indicated using their product would save us a great deal of money. As it turns out, the saving isn't anywhere nearly as close as, you know, as much as we had hoped, and we're recommending that we stay with the limestone. Those are the bid alternates that were, we've got one bid that we're rejecting, that's for acoustic panels. We didn't receive an actual bid. We received one fax bid and one incomplete bid. We sort of redrawn the scope of work for that package and are rebidding it to get more bids. With that, I can answer any questions that you might have about bid package 9.
Any questions? Do you want to speak while you're up here about 6.07 as well, and then we can combine the two? Would that work?
Last month, we presented some bids for bid package number 8, but in that presentation, we indicated that while we had received bids, we were still analyzing those bids, the construction manager and architect and I, and we would be making recommendations at a future meeting. This is that future meeting, and these are the recommendations. We have the same thing. We have the support building number 13, the bid alternate 13 for the support building. And we have also, and I think we discussed before, this spray-on fireproofing and insulation versus concrete roof that we discussed last month. Those were the only two bid alternates. I've interviewed all of the low bidders, and their bids are complete.
Questions, discussion?
Fresh memory on the, my memory on the fireproofing, which way did we decide to go?
We decided to go with a different type of insulation on the roof that provides a fire rating with a spray-on fireproofing below. It was less expensive, less weather sensitive than the poured in place concrete roof deck, which is both weather sensitive and was an equal cost.
Okay, I'd entertain a motion.
I would move to accept the bids and bid alternate listed in the bid summary and reject the bids for WP number 40. The acoustical panel is presented, and I'd also make a motion for 6.07 to accept the bids and bid alternates listed in the bid summary as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion for 6.06 and 6.07 by Mr. McCune and a second by Mike Poland. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes. Thank you, Greg, very much. I am amiss. I should have introduced Gail McKay. Gail, welcome, sitting up here today. She is our new deputy clerk and is helping our wonderful Joy learn the ropes, and Joy's teaching her. So thank you. We're glad to have you. Okay, 6.08, bid for white copy paper. Questions?
Dr. Berry, just curiosity out of this. As we go through school years, are we tracking how much paper we use year over year? Are we trending higher? Are we trending lower? Are we making any shifts from that standpoint? Because we bid this out and we get multiple bids throughout the year, so it's kind of hard for me to keep track of what we're trying to.
I can tell you we're trending pretty flat right now, but okay. We're hoping to start to trend down a little bit with the iPad deployment and other things that we're doing with the copy machines this year and the new software to track more of our usage. But we have been relatively flat. We've been bidding paper 3 times a year.
Okay.
And it's been for the exact same amount of trucks each time.
Okay.
So that's actually trending down when you consider enrollments growing.
That's true.
Good point. Thank you. Thank you very much. Motion?
I move to approve white copy paper bid to replenish the district's supply of copy paper in preparation for the summer fall order fulfillment with a minimum of 4 truckloads and a maximum of 7, with pricing held firm through September 2015 as presented.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Ms. Martin, second by Mr. McCune. Roll call vote, please.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
All right, 6.09, the Alice Safety Protocol Zach Tool Emergency Window Punch. Any questions?
You want to just cover what that is and the purpose for that?
Yeah, and I can get some help from staff if I need it. But you have been briefed on the new protocol that we have in place in terms of it's not just lockdown anymore, but at some point in the process, if we were to have somebody that's an intruder in our building, it is an option that we could safely escape. And so one of those ways to be escaping a building might be to go through a window. And so this is a tool that will be in each classroom, and we have training video for the, how to use it and so forth. Very simple, but it would allow us in an emergency situation to break a window safely, and we could escape that way and go to a safe place away from the school. So it's just one more option for all of our classrooms. This would be all of our classrooms in the district. And again, they've had training, and they'll be training on the tool, and it's been seen as very positive by our staff.
And typically, these would just be on the first floor?
That's a good thought, Mr. Shearer. I think that's in the training video, too. So I think we're
good question, right? How about a motion?
How will it be displayed or kept? What will there be a protocol for? It'll be kept?
Yes. A certain place in the room, and I believe it's Velcroed in, and it's... somebody's talked about, well, what if kids mess with it or try to, well, we have issues like that with other things sometimes, and it'd be part of our code of conduct. If you do something inappropriate, we would just address it with the principal and the teacher. So we're not concerned about that piece. The overriding piece of being safer is what is guiding this.
Well, much as it pains me to be approving a purchase of window breaking tools, it just seems slightly ironic. I will make that motion.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion by Dr. Daniels and a second by Mr. Shear. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune? Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
All right, 6.10, Student Transportation Services Agreement. Any discussion on this? John, would you like to come and just give an umbrella overview, Cliff Notes version?
The Cliff Notes version is we began this process several months ago with an RFP for our bus services. First Student was the winner of that RFP. We then began negotiating for the contract, which was presented as a future action item last month. And we're here this month for a five-year contract. As you can see, the rates are very heavy in the front year of the contract. That's really due to some of the labor trends going on in the area. The need for that front-end load is verified in the RFP process. The other bidder did a very similar thing, actually at a higher cost. It's really that the economy is coming back. Drivers are losing Kansas drivers to Missouri and other warehouses and other types of labor. So that's why it's a bit of an increase in year one, and then drops down immediately to less than a CPI rate for the remaining four.
John, you'd mentioned, what is the new language that you have written in here to control future costs?
Basically, there's language in the contract that allows us to sit down and negotiate. The contract really has three extensions after the 5 years that we can negotiate. That's the first step. We lock in at these rates. Otherwise, if the labor market were to get out of whack again, each party could ask to meet. It doesn't mean that you have to change the terms of the contract, but at least it calls that we sit down and discuss and determine if there's other viable options that we could look at. And then we have the ability to get out of the contract if we're displeased for any reason with a six-month notice.
I'm just curious to know, what's the implementation of a student tracking system?
Actually, there is an ID badge. If our students all had ID badges, there's a way to track whether or not a student's gotten on a bus, gotten off of a bus. So in the event that there was a missing child that didn't show up at home, or they on the wrong bus, perhaps we can put that in at any place. We originally had it immediately in year one, but we really have to look at how that card would work and how we would create the system around it in our district, so we can add it at any point in the contract.
I know this is a large budget item every year. Does it raise our liability as far as the costs or the coverage each year?
I'm not sure I'm following your question.
Just to, we have liability coverage for that, I assume, for our students.
The tracking, would it? I don't know that it would. The absence of that system, I'm not sure we would rate any differently if we had that in place or not.
Thanks.
John, I just had a question on paragraph 22, the required fleet equipment. that no bus would exceed 14 model years of age?
Yes.
Is that what it was in the last contract?
It was. We actually ended up keeping the average in the average age and the oldest age the same. First student felt strongly that they didn't want to get any older or they would start to have service problems also. There is quite a bit of exchanging of equipment that's going to go on in this five-year contract. As you recall, we kind of had extended it in our prior contract. Well, we need to replace buses mm-hmm. now. That's another reason some of that funding has to be in the first year. There's quite a few buses that will be replaced.
And the prior contract, I think, was 10 years? It was
prior
10.
To that,
it was 10.
Before my time, I'm not sure.
I understand. It was 10 years, and because of some of the constraints that we have on funding, because we get the district gets reimbursed from the state on this, but and we have pay riders, but that doesn't pay the full load on it.
Right.
We subsidize that out of the general fund.
Correct.
Correct.
And they were very comfortable going to 14 years. Beyond that, you have to have an extraordinary mechanic that's going to keep
sometimes,
them.
You know, some people tell me, you know, a neighboring school district has all nice, shiny buses, and some of our buses are kind of faded, and you can tell that they've got some age on them. And people have asked me about that. Why do they have shiny new buses and we don't? It's because of this right here. And if we had those shiny new buses, the bus contract would be considerably more than what we have. So the buses may not look new, but from a serviceability standpoint and a safety standpoint, we hold First Student accountable for that to make sure that the bus is safe and that it's serviceable and that it's well maintained, even though it does look a little faded.
Yes,
somewhat
sir.
Faded.
Yes, we do.
Right. And it's all, and this is all a budgetary issue.
Correct.
Okay. And I think it's important that our parents and our staff and our community understand that we're saving money by going 14 years on these buses, which typically probably nationally is probably 10 years.
Pretty much.
So we squeeze four more years out of them, which at the end of the day, we have to pay for that because when they buy a new bus, obviously they capitalize that to us.
What is the dollar impact of the first year increase?
Dollar impact of the first year is approximately $1 million. Not all of that is new cost. And what I mean by that is if it's a field trip, schools will have to make the choice whether or not that within their budgets is that the priority. So, but in a gross dollars, it's roughly $1 million.
Once again, used to be we had a lot of field trips, which we would subsidize. Those have been minimized in the past, and
right.
That has to come out of the school's activity fund
right.
budget. So.
And it should be noted that this increase occurs under the block grant as it stands today.
That's correct.
And the block grant has locked us in on funding equivalent to this year for the next 2 years. And so we'll have this $1 million increase in addition to student growth, and then we're working really hard on our insurance packages too, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So we're excited to have great bus service, but this isn't necessarily fabulous news, is it?
additional students will still show up at the beginning of school, and you're absolutely right, the funding is frozen, and we'll have to be working this into our existing budget.
Can you give us an idea what percentage of this will come from state, what percentage from pay riders, and what percentage we are subsidizing?
I couldn't do it right now, but I'd be happy
to
get
that
to information.
Us, I'd be curious.
Certainly.
Yeah.
Any other comments or a motion?
That was a good question, Ms. Martin. And I think, and when you get that number, it also what percentage is funded by through the state, in other words, what they pay for, and what do we end up paying mm-hmm. for mm-hmm. as a district? The $1 million, is that going to be all reimbursed by the state?
Not all.
Okay. Again, it would come back to these three
breakdowns. Special ed routes would
there's
be.
Three breakdowns, you know,
correct.
Pay riders, and there's what the state subsidizes and what we pay for out of the general fund.
Correct.
Except
so that $1 million, that's not a net number to the district.
No.
It's the increase, but.
Correct.
Right, okay. Now, I think the board would need to know that.
Except for new pay riders, the rest of it's on us because, as Lietta said, through the formula, we're not going to get any more transportation money next year. So this is a new $1 million above what we were paying last year.
And there's no more money to. I got it.
Nope. So except for pay ride, the rest will be on us.
Going to be a big fee for those bus riders.
And do we play with that pay rider fee to try to maximize the number of kids?
We have done that at some point. We compared to neighbors.
Well, I'm just wondering if there's a rate at which parents would say, yeah, I'd pay for that to get, you know, if the bus is already coming through their neighborhood.
Sure.
We might as well try to capture those kids.
We do look at those things. Another thing that we look at, just so you know, that one way that we could save some additional dollars is if we were able to run more double and even triple routes, meaning we would pick up a group and get them dumped off at a school and then go back for more. But it really hampers our starting times and ending times significantly in our district.
Well, and also, you're picking up kids at 6:30 in the morning.
Right.
Yes. It's not comfortable, yeah. Right?
Well, parents are not going to be.
What's our longest bus ride right now?
None of our bus rides exceed an hour, so we try to stay.
An hour?
Longest bus ride? Absolutely. Absolutely. We have kids, especially kids' routes on buses.
Yeah, we can't go to triple routes then.
Well, no, individuals.
You actually don't triple the length.
Oh, I see. You don't. Okay.
What you can do efficiently is you can, same bus, so we pay for a bus. Bus drops off at the middle school. Same bus then gets high school kids, drops them off. Same bus then drops off elementary. But we are so close in our starting times that you can't. So we run almost triple the number of buses because of the times of our school starting. But lots of routes run 50 minutes in the school district.
Really?
21st century routes that bring us high school student clear across town. So lots of very full routes running long already.
And just back to the pay rider issue, we've wrestled with that. It's kind of like school lunches, you know. You hate to raise the price because the people who need it the most, you know, single parents who have to go to work, you're putting pressure on their economy, their money, by raising that fee. Because it's always the people, it's always the kids, the families that need it the most. So it's a difficult decision to raise that.
I read an interesting article. It might have been in the American School Board Journal about an innovative district who was putting Wi-Fi on their buses because they had a one-to-one initiative with their students. And so those kids who were on the bus for an hour could be working on homework on those bus rides. Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
More money.
Yeah,
that's right.
I didn't consider that
another big capital outlay to our friends at First.
It was
students.
A great idea.
Good idea. Amy.
Just one more comment to my fellow board members. When we looked at the survey that parents said about the bus riders, obviously our parents are satisfied with that, and sometimes some of our drivers are a little disconcerted about the age of the buses and some of the other things that go on. And I always tried to explain to them that, you know, the parents are satisfied with it, and we're trying to run a bus company here and do it on the dime. So we need everybody to be patient with us, to include the drivers, and understand why it is what it is.
Yes.
Because they don't like driving those old buses. They'd like to be driving a nice, shiny new bus.
Older buses, excuse me.
Older.
And in the parent satisfaction survey, the one question that ticked down just a little about the satisfaction with being treated in a professional manner by the bus drivers, did we share that information with the bus company and the expectation that there will be a trend upwards next year?
We do, and there was that 1% decrease, but yes, we share those results with them. And they actually, in this contract, have some more concerted efforts for office coverage, which is one of the comments we've received on surveys about availability of somebody on the other end of that phone, and we've got guarantees on that now.
Great. And the customer service, it extends. It's not just with families. It's the students. They are customers, too, and they're aware of that, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Anything else?
I notice a lot of buses are parked with the "we're hiring" signs in our parking lots right now. Do we know how that's going?
You know, it's early now because it's for this next year, but they had a better year with us this past year, again, because of what John mentioned and Aaron, in terms of they benefits and pay better for those drivers, so they attracted some more. So it was much better, and we hope it'll continue to be that way. Yeah, no issues yet.
And just when you go back and look at the survey, the bus company is responsive to my concerns. Last year was 76%, this year 84%. So it is trending in a better direction. Last year it actually dropped from the year before. So First Student has made some great strides here in improving their customer service as it relates to talking to parents and students about their service and issues, so.
Very good. Motion?
I'd move to approve the attached multi-year student transportation services agreement with First Student as presented, and I would like to also thank John and his crew for, I know this has been a fun process. Okay, thanks.
Second.
Won't happen again for 5 years, though.
All right, I have a motion by Mr. Poland, a second by Mr. McCune. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Thanks for your hard work on that. That was a big project. Let's do two.
Lump the next three together? Anybody have any discussions?
Any discussion on the next three? We could lump them together.
The only thing I'd have is if you just kind of, Dr. Berry, if you kind of talk about 16.313, what that is and why we're changing those out.
Yeah, the system at East is an in-floor system. The sleeves in the floor, and it's become to the point where they need to be replaced. That company no longer is in business, and so we don't have the option of getting replacement parts. And so we have to replace those standards that are set up. So it's much more efficient if we just go ahead and put a system in the ceiling like we have at the main courts of our other high schools. It helps greatly in terms of setup time, flexibility for use of that gym during the day. So it just makes sense. This helps us to take care of it tonight so that we can get it installed in the summertime and be ready for practice.
And the funding came from?
Capital outlay.
I'd move to approve this on 6.11. I'd move to approve the escalating pricing option offered by AE Dairy for both milk-based products and 100% juice products as presented. For 6.12, I'd move to approve the low bid for the duct ventilation system at Olathe South High School as presented. And for 6.13, I would move to accept the recommendation as presented for the overhead volleyball standards purchase.
Second.
Okay, I've got a motion by Mr. Poland, second by Mr. Shear, for 6.11 to 6.13. Roll call vote, please.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Great. 6.13 would have typically been a future action item, but because it's summertime, we put it in on this agenda. That should be noted. So let's stop here. We will finish just a few more items of business, but we'll take a break. And if you haven't taken time to look at the awesome art displayed outside, you should. And then let's adjourn and let's come back, reconvene at 7 o'clock. Thank you. Welcome back. Welcome back. Can they hear me? No. I don't know if it's on. Oh, this was pushing. Welcome back and thank you for being here. I don't think it's working. Maggie, you can take it if you want.
Okay. Can you hear me? Is mine working? Okay. Welcome. Welcome. I'm thrilled. Good evening. I'm thrilled to be able to present our recognitions tonight. I'd like to welcome all of our distinguished guests. We're going to begin our recognitions tonight with a community partner, the Kansas City chapter of the National Tooling and Machining Association. I'd like to ask Heather Schoonover from Community Development and Matt Petrie from the 21st Century Aerospace and Engineering Program to come forward for the recognition, as well as the following. Michael Boning and Roger Gubbles from the KC chapter of the National Tooling and Machining Association, Gary Dobbins from NCS Precision Manufacturing, Ron Wozel from CNR Manufacturing, and Bill Goodman from A&E Custom Manufacturing. The NTMA focuses on fulfilling strategic initiatives of the network of industry partners that include the premier technology leaders of the world. Part of their advocacy for the industry was shown when the Kansas City local chapter connected with the Northwest High School BattleBots team through a generous $4,000 sponsorship to support the team's advancement to the national competition in May. Three association partnering companies also contributed in-kind donations of machine time valued at more than $12,000. The companies are CNR Manufacturing, NCS Precision Manufacturing, and A&E Custom Manufacturing. According to Matt Petrie, this has been a huge impact on the program by securing financial support. A highlight was having professional mentors assist with design reviews, mentoring students, and machining parts for robot design. The support of the NTMA provides invaluable resources that allow us to connect students' STEM knowledge, creativity, and passion to real-world skills and future career opportunities. Thank you to the NTMA staff and partner companies for your support to our students. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next recognition is of Camden Hanslick Burton from Olathe Northwest High School. Camden, if you could come forward along with Principal Gwen Paas. Camden was named the 2015 Outstanding Biology Teacher for Kansas by the National Association of Biology Teachers, and we just found out he was also named the National Outstanding New Biology Teacher by the National Association of Biology Teachers.
Awesome.
Candidates are judged on their teaching ability and experience, cooperativeness in school and community, inventiveness, initiative, and student-teacher relationships. Congratulations on both of these outstanding accomplishments. For our next recognition, I'd like to ask Dorothy Schuler, International Exchange Coordinator from EF High School Exchange Year, to come forward. The Olathe Public Schools has received national recognition for excellence in global education from EF High School Exchange Year. The EF High School Exchange Year Global Education Excellence Award is presented annually to high schools and districts that demonstrate an extraordinary commitment to international understanding and global awareness. The district was one of a select group of districts recognized from across the United States for the 2014-15 school year. Thank you so very much. Next, I'd like to ask Andrea Dahl from Olathe North to come forward, along with Assistant Principal Chad Breckheisen. Andrea won the Grand Award at the 2015 Greater Kansas City Science and Engineering Fair. This is the second year in a row she has won the Grand Award. She studied Antarctic penguins, looking at how the calls made by birds in different colonies varied by how far the colonies were from one another. She earned an all-expense-paid trip to compete at the Intel International Science and Engineering Fair, and get this, there she placed third out of all the participants. Congratulations.
Wow.
And Andrea, I know your family is here as well. We'd love for them to stand to be recognized. Our next recognition is of Cooper Yerby. Cooper, if you could come forward along with Assistant Principal Chad Breckheisen. Cooper just graduated from Olathe North and has been recognized as one of the country's most outstanding high school leaders by the Coca-Cola Scholars Foundation. As a Coca-Cola scholar, he has been awarded a $20,000 scholarship. He was selected from a pool of nearly 103,000 applicants. Congratulations. And Cooper, is your family here? We'd love for them to stand and be recognized as well. The recognition of outstanding graduates continues. I'd like to ask Ashwanth Samuel to come forward, along with Principal Gwen Paas. Ashwanth just graduated from Olathe Northwest High School, and he has been awarded a Jefferson Scholarship, one of the most highly selective merit scholarships in the nation. The Jefferson Scholars Foundation at the University of Virginia selected him as one of 34 recipients of this prestigious award. Congratulations to you. And is your family here tonight? We'd love for them to stand and be recognized as well. Next, we'd like to recognize the first robotics team from Olathe Northwest. Would the team, along with Coach Darren Wooster and Principal Gwen Pass, please come forward? The Olathe Northwest High School first robotics team, 1710, won both the championship competition with the robot and the chairman's award at the Greater Kansas City Regional Competition. This is the fifth time the team has won the chairman's award at the competition.
How to fix it.
Yeah.
The team also participated in the World Championships in St. Louis and did a great job there as well. Congratulations to you all.
Okay, we're going to need you to
squish together.
Two rows.
They do. We need the drill team. There you go.
Hey, good. Good.
His shirt.
Congratulations. Thank you. And are your families here? We'd love for you all to stand and be recognized. Next, we'd like to recognize students for placing first at the Kansas Skills USA competition. Would Kathy Musgrave please come forward to help with this recognition? For first place job skill demonstration, Michael Owenson from the Construction Trades Program, along with his instructor, Gary Anderson. You could come forward. And first place for auto technology refinishing, Ayasu McConnon from the Auto Tech Program, along with instructor Paul Katsoulis. And Alec Jorns from the Auto Technology Program placed first in related technical math, but was unable to be here tonight. We'd like to say congratulations to all three of these outstanding students, and we wish Owen and ISU all the best as they compete in nationals in Louisville, Kentucky later this month. Congratulations. And we'd love for your families to stand and be recognized as well. Congratulations. Next, I'd like to ask the Olathe North High School Science Olympiad team to come forward, along with teacher Julie Kissel and assistant principal Chad Reckheisen. The Olathe North Science Olympiad team recently represented Kansas at the National Science Olympiad competition in Lincoln, Nebraska. While the entire team did very well, two students placed first in their category. Arvin Submarinian and David Nelson, can you wave for me? Thank you. Placed first in technical problem solving. Congratulations to the entire team for your hard work and strong finish in the competition.
Bravo.
Congratulations, and we'd love for your parents to stand and be recognized as well. And next, we have a very special recognition. Would Vanya Shivashankar please come forward, along with California Trail Assistant Principal Carrie Ficken and Grace Hobson from the Olathe News. Vanya, who recently completed eighth grade at California Trail, was named co-champion of the Scripps National Spelling Bee last week after spelling numerous words correctly. Her final winning word was Sharon Schnitta. Sharon Schnitta? As the winner, she receives more than $37,000 in scholarships and prizes. This is the fifth time she's competed in the National Bee after winning the District Bee, which is sponsored by the Olathe News. Next year, she plans to go to Olathe North and take part in the Distinguished Scholars Program. Earlier this year, she was also named the winner of Child Genius, a show on Lifetime. Congratulations, Vanya, on all of your success. We are so proud of you. And I know Grace has the official dictionary, which is one of the prizes. One of the prizes from the for winning the District B. And I know your family is here as well. We would love for them to stand and be recognized. And finally, I'd like to ask Superintendent Marlon Berry to come forward to make a special presentation.
If Dr. Daniels and Harlan Parker would come down, please. Ralph Waldo Emerson said, "The purpose of life is not to be happy. It is to be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, to have it make some difference that you have lived and lived well." Dr. Debbie Daniels and Harlan Parker, along with their colleagues, have served on our local Board of Education because they had the desire to make a difference in the lives of the students, staff, and patrons who comprise the Olathe Public School District. Debbie and Harlan's tenure on our board has been honorable and compassionate. Dr. D and Harlan entered board service together on July 1st, 1999, so they have served parts of three decades. In the time they've served on the board, the Olathe District has grown almost 50%, adding more than 9,000 students during their tenure. Dr. Daniels and Harlan were on the board to open 11 new elementary schools, three middle schools, one high school, and to help plan the fifth high school. Debbie and Harlan have supported resources and policies to help prepare our students for the future. They have seen outstanding student, staff, and administrator recognition for the work being done in Olathe. They have valued greatly the work of our staff and administrators, and they have consistently provided a keen focus on what is best for our kids. Dr. Daniels, in her 14 years, gave of her time to serve as a board member at 291 board meetings. Harlan, during 16 years, served for 328 meetings. Please think about this with me as their act of volunteer service. 300 Thursday evenings they gave of their time to help guide the education efforts in our community. That's a commitment. As a district, we also thank the spouses and families of Debbie and Harlan. It takes great support from others to be able to give the time necessary to serve on the school board. Both Dr. Daniels and Harlan have had children go through our system. The next step is that we welcome Harlan's granddaughter, Riley, to kindergarten this year, and Debbie's oldest grandchild, Cohen, will soon follow. We will prepare them for their futures with the same care and compassion that you demonstrated for the thousands of kids in school during your tenure. Someday, Harlan's granddaughter will head off to K-State. Dr. Daniels' grandkids will go to KU. But they will be successful because of the type of families the two of you have raised. On behalf of the thousands and thousands of students, parents, staff, administrators, former board members, and patrons of our community, we thank you for your service to the kids of Olathe.
Any words you want to share?
Not me.
You are loved and appreciated. Okay, thank you guys who all came for recognitions. I'm really bummed. I wanted a selfie with Vanya. So, Vanya, are you still here? Could you come here a sec? Okay. If we position her here, I can get all of us. Would that be good, Vanya? Well, you come stand here, and then you guys look at the phone. We're kind of old, so we got to do this. I should have brought a selfie stick.
Oh, yeah.
We are so proud of you. Okay, so let's see. Okay, folks, lean in. You ready? One, two. Thank you. Thank you, Vanya. We DVR'd her, and my son has watched it probably 3 times, so we are fans. And I think we might need to add selfie sticks to our budget, you know, for just to, it's now a foundational element of our society. Okay, so we're at Action Other 7.01, the general insurance. Oh, forgive me, I was speeding ahead. We have time for public comments. Rick?
All right, absolutely. At each regular meeting, the Board of Education reserves limited time for individuals wishing to address the board. We request that individual speakers limit their comments to 5 minutes. The clerk will monitor the time and notify the speaker when the 5-minute time limit has expired. Please direct your comments to the entire board. If a response is appropriate, the president will respond or refer to another individual. In an effort to respect privacy, we ask that speakers refrain from discussing personal complaints involving individual staff members or students. Those speaking are advised that public comments are videotape recorded for broadcast on the district's educational access channel and audio tape recorded as a matter of public record. Individuals addressing the board should come to the podium at the front of the room and state your name and address. And I do understand that we do have one person that had registered prior, and that is Dana R. Tuttle. Are you here, Dana?
Good evening. My name is Dana Tuttle, and I reside at 1020 West Fairwood Lane, Olathe, Kansas, 66061. I've been an Olathe resident for 23 years. My topic for this evening is Olathe High School graduation ceremonies for the Olathe School District. I have 3 children that have graduated from this district recently. In 2014, my daughter from Olathe North. My sons, they are twins, this previous May 2015, from Olathe North and Olathe South. Our school district is now at a capacity where I am requesting that we please stagger or look for alternatives for our high school graduation ceremonies. Having twins and being a single parent for 14 and a half years, I decided to let both of my children participate in the 21st century programs, even though we reside in the Olathe Northwest District. And I knew there would come a time where it would be difficult to be in 2 places at one time. Mr. Morford and Mr. Clark both accommodated and assisted as much as they could, but their hands were tied since all of our ceremonies are at 7 o'clock p.m. on Sunday evenings. So rushing across town with my daughter and husband, it was a very frantic and stressful time, including chest pains and high anxiety. I missed half of one son's graduation and the other half of my other son's, but they both were able to participate in the 21st century programs like they had wanted. So to be selfless, we gave that up for them. But looking in the future in our district, we currently have, as of May of 2015, 29,492 full-time students. Blue Valley has 21,819. Blue Valley this past year rented out Kemper Arena on a Saturday and Sunday afternoon for $32,000. They were able to have 5 graduation ceremonies. I personally am not wanting our district to spend $32,000 on a facility. Shawnee Mission School District had theirs staggered on 3 days at their outdoor facilities, weather permitting. We need to please look at alternatives for our future families and employees of the district and our community members. In 15 years, Dr. Fasulo may have to make a choice as to which grandchild's graduation she goes to, since she also has twin grandchildren. And it's not fair to hold those children back from choosing 21st century programs. This past May, grandparents had to make the choice in the district, since we are so large, as to which grandchild to go see walk across the stage. The Carpenter family was affected. The Felter family was affected. There are many families in our community that are affected by us having graduation on one evening. So I do ask that the district and the board and Superintendent Barry, Dr. Barry, please take this under reconsideration and please help our community as we grow and allow these children that do want to participate in 21st century, that have either blended families, multiples of twins or triplets, foster families, or blended families of other reasons, and grandparents, please don't make them make the choice as to which graduation they go to or that they don't go at all. So if you'd please take that under consideration, we'd greatly appreciate it. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dana, very, very much, and congratulations on your graduates. So we do very often study this subject. It is something we believe we can do better. It's just there's not a lot of easy answers, are there, Dr. Barry?
No, but we'll share that information back with you and always continue to talk with the principals and work on that.
Good. Maybe at some near future meeting, we could just do a quick summary. I know we did one a couple years ago, and you know, it seems like an easier fix than it is because of the dynamics of all the moving parts. But Dana, thank you for coming very much, and we will take to heart your words. Thank you. All right.
Is there anybody else that would like to address the board this evening? Seeing none, thank you.
Thank you, Rick, very much. Okay, we will move on to action item 7.01, general insurance policy renewal for the fiscal year 2016. And I see Merle walking to the front. So you did this and the bus. You had fun this year, huh?
Good evening. And as James shared on the way up, there's no better way to kill a room than to talk about insurance. So that's what we're here to do.
Harlan knows that.
The information that you have for our renewal in front of you, we've invited a couple gentlemen in this evening.
Until it comes claim time.
Yeah, that's right.
So we have with us this evening Ed Reasoner with Thomas McGee & Associates. They're our third-party administrator for the school district in regards to our property casualty, liability, and workers' comp insurance programs. In addition, joining us this evening is James Charlesworth with Charlesworth & Associates, who are the district's insurance advisors. So Ed has a very brief comment in regards to the information that you have in front of you for this evening.
Thank you, Merle, and the board, for the opportunity to meet with you. A couple of weeks ago, we did meet with the insurance committee to go through the insurance renewal proposals. In the past, I've had the opportunity, to present some disturbing numbers or higher numbers than prior years. The thing with insurance, it is very much driven on catastrophes and major losses in the global and U.S. In the past years, we've seen those. In the current year, we have not. That, as a result, insurance companies have made money, both on lack of having large losses, as well as more favorable investment community. It's a more robust society. So as a result, and presented for renewal, is a reduction that we've seen, primarily driven on the reduction in the property insurance, both in a reduction in the premium, as well as more favorable terms on the wind and hail deductible that we've seen in the past. And that concludes.
That's good.
Comments.
Any questions? Comments? Okay.
Just one comment on the wind deductible. Travers wants $500,000 on a wind deductible, and we're buying that down to $250,000 with the $13,000 on premium.
Due to the change in the market, Travers reduced that to from $500,000 to $250,000 wind and hail deductible.
Okay. And we're still buying it down for the $250,000 with the what's the $13,000 to Lloyd's for?
The $13,000 is basically to purchase the most of the policy is for a $100,000 deductible. The $13,000 is basically a buy down deductible that covers the $150,000 loss for a wind and hail to take it to the $250,000.
Okay.
Any questions? Did James have any comments, or he's here just to help if need be? Is that right, James?
Yes, ma'am. We do benchmark programs with other similar districts that we handle and know of, and we did confirm that this program is an excellent program. The terms and condition and pricing is very competitive with similar districts of this size and makeup. So Thomas McGee has done a very good job.
Good. Thank you for that. Thank you. If board members don't have any further questions, I'd entertain a motion.
Just one comment. Do note that probably the only thing in the district that's gone down this year is $69,458.
That's good.
I'd move for approval as presented.
Second.
All right. I have a motion by Mr. Parker, a second by Dr. Daniels. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Thank you so much, guys. Thank you. Okay, we have a couple of student trips. We have Olathe South Forensics going to Dallas in June, and Olathe East Forensics also going to Dallas.
Move for approval for student trips 7.02 and 7.03 as presented.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Parker made the motion, second by Dr. Daniels, for 7.02 and 7.03. Roll call vote, please.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
That sounds like a fun trip. Hope they learn a lot. We need good forensic students. Future action items, 8.01 through 8.09. We have our Head Start transportation info. We have three student trips. Salary reimbursement agreement with Kids TLC. We have school resource officers agreement. The Mill Creek Architectural Engineering Proposal, acceptable use policy for students in technology, and bids for musical instruments for growth in band and orchestra. Any comments or questions on our future action items?
8.07, Greg, could you give us what direction we've given the architects, or we will be giving them? I mean, we're leaving it the open slate for them to come up with suggestions and ideas, or have we given them some direction?
Well, as you may remember, I think Mr. Hutchison at a previous meeting had presented sort of a phasing plan that we're considering the schematic design for the project. So all they're doing is taking that schematic design development, and converting it into working drawings. So typical of that process, the schematic design development has been completed. We're just now turning that into working drawings, and obviously there'll be decisions that are having to be made as they investigate the site and uncover as-built conditions. But I think the direction's already been given to them, which is the plan that Mr. Hutchison presented previously.
From an exterior standpoint, do we have any direction? You know, I'd express some concern that I'd sure love to see the outside of the entry area be a lot like the old John P. St. John?
Well, right now, I think the scope of the work is primarily an exterior renovation, not a rebuilding, trying to take some of the windows from the annex and blend them in with the original building so that they look a little more alike, maybe some windows in the gymnasium.
We're not doing those hallways or connecting ways, too?
I think the interest that you had also, if we tie on a place where you come in on the what's going to be the new front side,
yes,
the administration type area that has the security coming in, that if we could incorporate some of the old archways or the look of the building to keep it that way.
The glass, you know, connecting, you know,
The new entry. The new entry will be on the south side of the building, which will be right now proposed to be primarily glass.
Okay.
But it will obviously take on the characteristics of the existing building and the design. And we haven't seen those elevations yet,
yeah,
but they'll be derived from the floor plans that we already have.
Okay, so those glass connecting points are part of this design?
Yes.
Okay.
The intention here is they will do a complete set of working drawings for the complete building, where before we presented a plan that's basically six or seven different phases, they will do the drawings for the complete building. And then from that, we'll develop phasing if as needed.
Okay. I'll put my request in again for some sort of decoration to the trailers that are out there, some sort of screen from the neighborhood so that it'll look more attractive to the neighbors.
Okay.
Thank you. Anything else? All right, we received some written information. 9.01 was the April Head Start Director's Report. We also received 9.02, the Annual School Site Council Report, the 9.03 Partnership with Baker University for On-Site Master's Program in School Leadership and or Building Licensure. Very interesting reading. Okay, topics for discussion. Now's the time for board members to bring up topics for discussion that were not on the agenda. Does anyone have any items? Okay, nothing? Dr. Berry.
I'll make one quick introduction. She's not been on TV with Jimmy Kimmel like Vanya has been, but Jessica Dane is in the audience tonight. Jessica, if you would stand. Dr. Dane is our new Executive Director, Assistant Superintendent of Teaching and Learning that will be joining us officially July 1st. But thanks for being here tonight.
Welcome.
We also have news from today. It's wonderful when we get to recognize our staff and students like we did this evening. But the news from today is that Dr. Josh Anderson, whose picture already appears on the wall behind me as being a Kansas Teacher of the Year in previous years, was named today as the National Speech and Debate Teacher of the Year. So a national award top teacher. So that's pretty exciting for Dr. Josh Anderson. I want to share, everybody always asks, well, what are we hearing from Topeka, what's coming out and so forth, and unless somebody has even fresher news, they are still working on the tax plan to bring the revenue into play so that they can fund what they've already done in terms of education, which is the block grants. They have the conference committee evidently came up with some consensus on things, and so at 5 o'clock tonight, the House was supposed to start to look at it in detail. It took the afternoon to get printed, and then the Senate meets tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock to see what happened with the House and whether they can start to make movement on that. Here's my understanding of how they're trying to fill the hole with the needed revenue, that they will boost the sales tax from 6.15 to 6.65. On July 1st, and then in January, they're gonna drop the sales tax on food to 5.9%, so that's the first piece. They also came up with a compromise, but they are gonna put a tax on cigarettes. The House wanted 65 cents, Senate put in 50 cents, so that's where it resides right now. This package of taxes is supposed to bring in $432 million this next year. Mm. Both the House and the Senate and the conference committee stayed away from changing the tax status of any of the LLCs, which is, as you've read, that's been a contention point. But they did make a cut. 50% of the individual income tax deductions for your mortgage and for your property taxes will it'll be cut to 50%. The charitable deductions will stay at 100%, but they did do the deductions for home mortgage interest and property taxes. And then the other piece that they did, as you know, the income tax rates for Kansas were to continue the march towards zero, as you've heard that phrasing. They are freezing that at the 2.7 and the 4.6 rate until 2018. So that also allows for a little bit more revenue to be there, or at least not as much of a deficit as we get into the next 3 years. So that's where it sits right now, and we'll see what's happening tonight and then what the Senate does with it tomorrow. I want to change to summer conference that we had last week, and Jan Heinen, Luann Hermrick, and others put on a wonderful conference again right here in Olathe. The numbers are still being crunched a little bit, but over 1,700 teachers participated in that. And one of the really neat things is it plays into the things that we have already being planned in terms of this past year and for the future year in terms of staff development. So we get to hold this right here locally, but we had teachers and others come from more than 11 different districts. And I think childcare centers and so forth, because all the strands that we have. So they help us pay for that, but yet all of our teachers get to take advantage. So again, a wonderful conference that takes an awful lot of time to put on. We are in the summer shutdown, and John in the business department and the service center, Tom Lillis and others, our energy people, are trying to shut the district down so that we can realize some savings this summer. So food production to date has unplugged all equipment in the buildings. This is just to give you a few pieces so you know what happens. The secondary schools are working on as well so that all of our freezers are shut down for the summertime. We even pair back at the central office at the food production with Scott Kingery. They work hard to narrow down to as minimal freezer space as they can in terms of saving us dollars. They've gone through buildings, our custodians working with the principals, and so that in all classrooms we've asked teachers to unplug technology and personal appliances and so forth. We really watch our HVAC scheduling over the summertime. If we have groups in, it's just for that area and for that time. Otherwise, we try to utilize some savings potential by shutting those things down. Construction is going full tilt, as Greg will say, and Travis. We now have more construction work going on this summer than we did last summer. Again, so extremely busy out in our schools. And to date, the rain has not really hampered us too much. In fact, even today, Greg said at the high school, they continue to work. So we want to stay on that progress, particularly with Olathe West, so that we can see it come up out of the ground. And by the end of this year, when the weather starts to turn, we can be inside and start to continue working that way. A reminder quickly about the advocacy meeting with KASB, which is here June 23rd, if you're able to do it. Love to have you here for that. And then I know we said goodbye to two of our board members this evening, but there are also several administrators who are attending officially their last board meeting. Luann Hermerich, Lloyd Letcher, Jim Payne, Kathy Musgrave. They can always come back if you would like to, but officially the last board meeting, and we thank them for all of their service. That's all I had, unless you have questions.
Questions? I noticed Lloyd laughed really loud when you said that you could come back. We would love to have you guys back. Okay, do we need an executive session?
We do. 30 minutes, please.
30 minutes. Okay. I would entertain a motion.
I move to the board to adjourn to executive session for the purpose of discussing personnel matters of non-elected personnel, discussing matters relating to employer-employee negotiations, and consulting with an attorney for the body or agency, and that the board return to the regular meeting at 10 after 8 in this room. Executive session is required in order to protect the privacy interests of the individuals to be discussed, to protect the district's right to the confidentiality of its negotiating position, and to protect attorney-client privilege and the public interest.
Second.
All right, I have a motion by Mr. Poland, second by Amy Martin. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Poland?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Dr. Daniels?
Yes.
Mr. Parker?
Yes.
Thank you.